And now that it's guest star time in Hollywood. This is Gene Norman, your man about music.
I always thought of myself as an impresario, you see. I'm the only guy I know of that's presented music in radio, television, concerts, nightclubs, records, and publishing. When I was a kid, I lived in New York. When John Hammond, that marvelous person, brought Basie to New York with his own money, they played the famous Door. I used to go to Manhattan for a nickel in the subway, go in the famous Door, and that band was Lester Young and Harry Edison, Joe Jones, and I didn't have any money. I was 16 years old, so I used to hang around, you know, and I'd try to avoid everybody. Finally, they'd kick me out. You want to buy a drink? No, I'm waiting for somebody, right? So maybe 15 years later, Basie's working for me at my nightclub. So some kid walks in and digs the band. I walked up to him and said, "You're always welcome here. Can I buy you a drink?" Shortly thereafter, I was very honored that Basie named one of his single records after me. He called it Normania. So I went through the whole thing with Basie.
Very fortunate. I never had to work for a living. I did exactly what I loved, and I made my passion into my profession.
I had a natural progression, a classical violinist in a family of five musicians, band saxophone player in college.
In fact, in college at the University of Wisconsin, which I loved, I took a vocational aptitude test. The psychiatrist said, "I've never seen a result like yours. You only have one choice. Everyone else has two or three. Music. That's my field, and I'm very fortunate to have succeeded in it."
It was the beginning of the disc jockey era, and I know that that was perfect for me because presenting music is what I do. So I became a DJ, and I went up the radio ladder. I worked Fresno, Oakland, San Francisco. I had a backstage show as part of my duties. In the days when the Paramount New York, a Chicago theater in Chicago, the Fox in Detroit used to play bands in a movie. So I knew everybody. When I came to LA from NBC in San Francisco, from KGO to KFWB, and I became a staff announcer, and then they gave me 2 hours a night to be a DJ. In those days, this was in the mid-40s, right after World War II, there were only 14 signals in Southern California. No TV, no FM. I had the music scene all to myself every night.
Unfortunately, I didn't buy radio stations when I could have, but it was just marvelous that I had such loyal following. And people would recognize me by my voice. That was a gift. Some people are handsome, brilliant. I got a great voice.
Anyway, the way the jazz concert started was, I knew all the leaders because I interviewed them on the radio. I was on then 10 to 12 at night. It was 1947. I'd been here 3 years. And I called Benny Goodman, my original idol, and said, "Benny, why don't we put on a concert?" He says, "Great, how much will you pay me?" He was probably the greatest instrumentalist that ever lived. I was a 25-year-old kid, I didn't know what to say. So I said, "How about $200? And he laughed and said, "Okay." To this day, I don't know whether he thought I was trying to take advantage of my position or I just didn't know any better. The truth is, I didn't know any better. So I called Peggy Lee and she came, and I called Errol Garner and he came. Charlie Barnett came. Finally, everybody wanted to get on the thing. We went to Pasadena because there's 3,000 seats, a marvelous auditorium, and we were looking for quality. I started plugging it on the radio. The tickets were $1, $1.50, and $2. It was April of 1947. We had a wonderful time, and I'm glad my sponsor was there because he was really impressed. I realized I was in the concert business, so then the second concert was Nat Cole. I can't say enough about Nat. He was the most charming, knowledgeable, soft-spoken. I loved Nat.
Hi, Gene.
Nat, is this where you do all your composing and practicing?
Well, yes, right here at home. I look at everything right here. This is where all my tunes are made up, my arrangements, and my ideas.
Are you teaching the youngsters to play?
Well, no, I'm not exactly teaching them to go into the professional side. If they want to do it, I mean, I'll encourage it. If not, I'll just let it go. Hey, Skis, I'd like you to say hello to Gene and the people out there.
Hello, Gene. Hello, everybody.
Hiya, Marie. Would you introduce us to the children?
Yes, this is Natalie Maria, better known as Sweetie. Say hi, Sweetie. Say hi.
Sweetie?
Hi! And this is Carol, better known as Cookie. Say hello, Cookie.
Hello.
Every night I play two Nat Cole records. In fact, there were so few records that I had to play broadcast transcriptions to get enough Nat Cole to play. For 16 years after that, we put on shows at least once a month. See, I was very lucky. I got to all these concerts free, and all I ever did was play what I wanted to see. The reason I opened the first nightclub in 1948, my dear friend Carlos Gastel, who managed Stan Kenton, Mel Torme, Peggy Lee, Nat Cole, and Woody Herman, I just acquired Woody, and he came into the studio one night and said, "Gene, we got to open a nightclub. Woody's got no place to play." So we took over the old Tom Brenneman's on Vine Street
and called it the Empire.
And Woody opened. I'll never forget that band as long as I live. It was Stan Getz, Zoot Sims, Al Cohen, Shorty Rogers, Red Rodney, Bill Harris, Don LeMond. Unbelievable. I was in heaven. They were there for 4 weeks. We followed with Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and then ABC bought the building, and that was the end of it. They made it into a studio. Art Tatum was at the Swanee Inn on La Brea, and I went there every night. I worshipped Art Tatum, and later, you know, it was like a dream come true. I had the pleasure of presenting him. I had started to record these things for myself, for my own collection. It was never an idea of making records. The way I got into the record business, I started actually with Modern Records, a small R&B label. They had B.B. King, that was good. They came to me and said, "Do you have any jazz records?" Because Jazz at the Fill was already doing well. I started with them, and they put out a lot of great stuff of mine. And one night, Mitch Miller was at my place for dinner, and I played him Art Tatum, and he said, "I gotta have that." He put it out on Columbia, and that thing has been selling all over the world. I was giving my records to RCA, Decca, and Columbia, and once I gave them an All-Star Dixieland Jubilee thing, and the sales department didn't think it would sell, so they held it for 3 years. I said, "I'm gonna put up with this," so that's when I started GNP. What is it called? G. Norman Presents. That's where the GNP comes from. And then when everybody had an alphabet label, I added the crescendo. Dizzy Gillespie had made some records on RCA, and I loved them. You know, Ooh Papa Da, all those. He was a sensational trumpet player. He was humorous. He had gone to Europe, and they practically had to swim home because they laid a total egg. Nobody knew who it was. So I leaned on it night after night. Finally, the big band came in with James Moody and Jono Pozzo, because Jono died shortly thereafter. And it's one of the most exciting things I've ever heard in my life. The Latin beat. But Dizzy and I remain friends forever.
Well, Greta, thanks for being with us. You hold the album. All right, now here's your riddle, and please don't help her. Let her get it fair and square. What stays hot even in the refrigerator? What do you eat on hot dogs?
Chili.
Chili. That stops me, I'm sorry. If you didn't eat chili on hot dogs, what would you eat?
Onion.
Onion? All right, let's try again. What else would you eat on a hot dog?
Mustard.
How did you get that? All right, good for you. You win the album. Have a nice trip home.
When I was on radio and TV, Chuck Landis had a club on 8th Street called the Tiffany. He used to play Nat Cole and George Shearing. It was kind of a little jazz club. And I used to help him at the Tiffany by plugging it off the radio and TV. Got to know him very well. And then the Crescendo Nightclub became available to us. He called me. He says, "You want to go in with me?" I said, "Sure, if you want to run the bar and all that." I had learned how to buy talent from the concert business. And the secret I learned very early is that you package. You never present one thing. So went in there with Chuck, and I was with him for about 2-3 years. But he had no concept of a heavy three-act program. He played the Ink Spots and the Mills Brothers and level like that. And finally, he wanted to buy me out, see, because there was a little friction there about booking acts. He offered me a very low price. I said, "Well, for that money, I'll buy you out."
Even though at that time I was on radio 8 hours a day and TV, I used to do 4 to 6 on radio tape, do 4 to 6 on TV, live, and then go to dinner and go back and do 4 more hours of radio. We went into the Crescendo in 1954. We started our record company at the same time, GNP Crescendo Records. I was a busy guy. We came in after Macombo and Ciro's were the reigning nightclubs on the Sunset Strip. Crescendo was right in between both of them. And then after a year or two, we took over the room upstairs, the Interlude. The Interlude was the starting room. Lenny Bruce started there, Woody Allen started there, Shelley Berman started there, Mordsall. And that was always a comic and a small group, like the Modern Jazz Quartet or the Dave Brubeck Quartet or Shelley Mann and his men. So we had the two clubs going at the same time. The Crescendo became a great recording venue. There were at least 50 live albums made during the shows at the Crescendo on various labels. Everybody from Ella Fitzgerald to Billy Daniels, George Shearing. We made two Louis Armstrong albums at the Crescendo. I produced a live album with Mel Torme. He was on contract to Decca Coral at the time, a very vivacious entertainer. The man who owned the building was a shady character named Bill Dorr. And one night, some underworld figures came to his home on Fountain Avenue and apparently assassinated him. And there was a sub-headline in the LA Times that said, "Owner of the Crescendo murdered." You can't believe the phone calls I got on that one. I had 400 seats in the club. That was the capacity. And although we filled the seats, I knew there was much greater potential in the music business. After 10 years in the clubs and 20 years on the radio every night, I was ready to see the world, so I decided to concentrate on the music business, records and music publishing. Since then, I've been in Europe 50 times, and it's marvelous. No matter where I've gone in the world, I've met jazz people. My favorite line is, "Chocolate melts, flowers die, but music lasts forever." That's the secret of jazz. It's timeless and it's universal.